It should be. Equal to 2 pi cube over omega, but I'm asking you to calculate it explicitly once you have determined the primitive vector of the reciprocal lattice. So this is for the hexagonal lattice. So this is still related to crystal structure and the Brillouin zone. Okay, so I will continue now with the part on electronic state in a crystal. So we had seen the Bloch theorem, and now I would like to give you some consequences of the Bloch theorem. Consequences of the Bloch theorem. So we have seen that if we have a Hamiltonian having the periodicity of a given Bravais lattice, the eigenstates, the solution, phi of R can always be written in the Bloch form, that is exponential AIKR times a function UK that is periodic, that has the periodicity of the Bravais lattice or the crystal structure we consider. Okay, now in principle, K can be any real vector. But now I will show that actually one can restrict that to K inside the Brillouin zone. So let's consider a lattice in two dimensions. So I consider, for example, a square lattice. And I have my Brillouin zone here. So this is, I'm considering a square lattice, and this would be its reciprocal lattice, and I consider a K vector that is in principle outside the Brillouin zone. So this is the reciprocal lattice, and I consider a K, let's say here, a K point, let's see, take it a little bit less symmetric. So something here, for instance. And this is my vector K that is outside the Brillouin zone. So this would be the Brillouin zone. Corresponding to my reciprocal lattice here. So I have my K vector here. And I can always look for the reciprocal lattice point that is the closest to my K vector. So this would be this one. This would be the corresponding G vector. So this is K, this is G, and the difference between the two in red would be a vector that is in that would belong to the Brillouin zone. So K here would be K inside the Brillouin zone. So basically, I can write my K vector as the G vector plus K inside the Brillouin zone. You can always do that looking for a given, well, I have an arbitrary point K in the reciprocal space. I look for the reciprocal lattice vector that is closest to my point K. So this is the vector G. And I can always write my vector K as G plus a small vector, K Brillouin zone, that is a vector that belongs to the Brillouin zone of my reciprocal lattice. So I can always do that with a K vector outside the Brillouin zone. So now I can therefore rewrite this as exponential I K inside the Brillouin zone times R times exponential I J my vector R times the function mu k of R. I can do that also in three dimension. It's general. So now this part is periodic, has the periodicity of the Bravais lattice. This part, by definition, is periodic, and here exponential ijr, we have seen that the reciprocal lattice vector j have the properties that they make the plane wave periodic, with the periodicity of the Bravais lattice. So this part is periodic, and therefore, without any loss of generality, I can always write a Bloch function with an arbitrary k as a Bloch function with a k inside the Brillouin zone times a periodic part, which I can call u of k inside the Brillouin zone. So whatever Bloch function I have, I can always rewrite it in the form of a Bloch function with a k inside the Brillouin zone, because I have this exponential ik r with k inside the Brillouin zone times a periodic function. So without any loss of generality, I can focus just on the k vector inside the Brillouin zone. Is it clear? Okay. Any Bloch state can always be rewritten as in the form of a Bloch state with k inside the Brillouin zone. All right. The form, it's the form that matter. By definition, a Bloch state is a state that is written as this type of exponential times a periodic function. So I can always rewrite a Bloch state with k outside the Brillouin zone as a Bloch state with k inside the Brillouin zone. Is it okay? You agree?
But excuse me, mm-hmm. I thought that the Brillouin zone is that small square that you've drawn there.
Yes.
Yeah, but then KBZ is out.
No.
Shifted parallel.
No. KBZ is the small thing in red. I mean, okay.
And it is.
If you want, my K Brillouin zone is inside the Brillouin zone of associated with this G vector, or the Wintersite cell, if you want, associated with this point in reciprocal space, and I can always shift it inside the first Brillouin zone. So the vector itself, which is just this red thing, the red arrow, belongs to the Brillouin zone. It's a vector, with zero, I mean, starting at zero and finishing here.
So it means that the Brillouin zone that you have drawn here can be
translated
to the other place to cover.
It's a vector that has, it's just a vector. So the vector has a length which is fully included inside the Brillouin zone.
Okay.
So I can always rewrite this. So the first consequence of the Bloch theorem is that without any loss of generality, one can just focus on the Bloch function with a k inside the Brillouin zone of our reciprocal lattice. So Bloch theorem can just be restated with, if I have a Hamiltonian like this, minus h bar square, Laplacian square, Laplacian over 2 times the mass of the electrons plus the crystal potential V of R with V of R periodic, namely having the periodicity of a given Bravais lattice, then the solutions or any solution can be written as psi of R is equal to exponential I k R u k of R with u k of R periodic, and the k belonging to the Brillouin zone of my system. So one can restate the Bloch theorem focusing just on k inside the Brillouin zone. Okay, so this is a consequence. Now a second one, which will be actually give us the solution of for the u of k. We progressed in the sense that now we have this form for the eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. So the first part is fixed, and we just have now to find the uk of R. But we have already simplified quite a bit the problem, because we can solve separately the problem fixing the k. And then we have just to look for a solution inside the unit cell. So we have simplified quite a bit the problem, because we just need to find a solution inside the unit cell of the crystal, because we know that uk of R is periodic, so we need a solution inside the unit cell with periodic boundary condition on the border of the cell. So now we are going to try to find this solution uk of R. So our initial problem is h of psi is equal to epsilon eigen value times psi. And we know that the solution will be exponential I k R times u of R. And this must be equal to epsilon I k R u of R. Now, our Hamiltonian has the form minus h bar square gradient square divided by 2m plus v of r. So, and this is our Hamiltonian, and we therefore will have to derive twice the product of two functions. So this we know what it is. If one applies twice the derivative to the product of two functions, this increase. So if I apply gradient square on a product of two functions f times j, I obtain the second derivative of f times j plus 2 times the gradient of f times the gradient of j, and then I have the f times the second derivative of j. So I just apply twice the gradient. That's what you obtain. Okay, so now we will use it here. So my equation here is minus h bar square gradient square over 2m plus v of r, the exponential I k r times u is equal to exponent to epsilon, the eigenvalue I k r times u. And now I use this on this product. So I'm getting minus h bar square over 2m times. So if I derive twice the exponential, I obtain minus k square. So minus k square exponential I k times r times u. Then I have this part, so 2. And if I derive, I take the gradient of exponential ik r, I obtain ik. So 2 times ik times exponential ik r. And then I have to take the gradient of u, gradient of u, and then the third term is exponential I k r times the Laplacian of u. So this was just applying that to this product. And then I have still the potential, so V of r times exponential I k r u. So this is the right hand side of my equation, and this is equal to epsilon times I k r u. Okay, so the good thing about the exponentials is when one derives, one still obtains the exponential, so I can simplify all this exponential IKR on the left-hand side and right-hand side, and I obtain thus an equation just for U. If I summarize, I'm getting minus h bar square over 2m Laplacian plus 2 times I k times the gradient minus k square, and this applies to U. I inverted the order because I want an equation for U. So this is what one gets here. So plus V of R, the crystal potential acting on U, is equal to epsilon U. So this is the equation I'm getting for U, and I can just rewrite it also as h bar square over 2m, the gradient plus ik square, apply plus the potential V of R, and this applying to U on U is equal to epsilon U. Okay, right, and this I can actually call this part, I can call it an operator HK. So I have HK U is equal to epsilon U with U periodic. And for each k, for each k point in the Brillouin zone. So I have to solve this. H of k, we call it H of k, it's like a Hamiltonian at a given k point acting on U. Actually, it's not a real Hamiltonian, but it has very good property. It's a Hermitian operator. So, second order Hermitian type of operator, so it has very good properties. The eigenvalue will be real, and so we call it just the Hamiltonian at k, but it's an effective Hamiltonian. Okay, so it's a second order differential operator, which is Hermitian. And this has good properties because now we have just to solve this on a finite volume. So inside the Brillouin zone, we have to find the solution U of this eigenvalue problem. with just the periodic boundary condition over on the size or on the sides of the unit cell. So one has to solve the problem in a finite volume, and the consequence when one has second order derivative permission operator and one has to solve it over a finite volume with some condition, either periodic or normal, the properties is that one will obtain discrete eigenvalue. So for a given k, because k is fixed, so once you fix the k, you have a given h of k, and the property is that the epsilon that will come out will be a discrete energy spectrum. So you can label your eigenvalue. So the consequence of solving this on a finite volume on the unit cell box is that one will obtain a discrete one would obtain a discrete spectrum. So I fixed the k. Here I have a fixed k. I do everything for a given k. So I will have eigenvalue epsilon of k, and I can label them with n. So 0, 1, 2, 3, going up in energy, and the corresponding eigenstate u n of k that are function in the unit cell that actually form a complete basis. One includes all the n, so yeah, I will have one and so on. But it's going to be discrete eigenvalue. So let's look at an example, first in one dimension, of what one can. What this is going to be. So I'm considering now an example.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Ma'am, we just found out that the k can be restricted inside the Brillouin
yeah.
zone.
Yeah.
But here we are talking about two different spaces at the same time, real and reciprocal. So the k is in reciprocal
yes.
space and the equation is in real space because there is
No. Okay. This is, you have to see k as a quantum number, a good quantum number. I mean, this comes from the fact that the Hamiltonian commutes with the translation operator in real space. And we have seen that this gives, I mean, one can prove it, I didn't prove it, you can look at in Ashcroft and Merling for the proof, but once one has the condition that the Hamiltonian commutes with the translation operator of the Bravais lattice, then one can prove the Bloch's theorem, that is, the eigenstate of the Hamiltonian will have the form, the Bloch form. This is a consequence. So I showed you, I mean, the Bloch form is exponential ikr uk of r, so the eigenstate have a good quantum number, this k. This is a quantum number that labels each eigenstate, and the reason one has this is that one has also the translation symmetry. So this is a quantum number that is related to the translation and belongs and corresponds to the eigenvalue of the translation state. So K is just a good quantum number in reciprocal space, if you want, but it's just to label the states. Okay. Then the states are in real space.
Okay. We are working in real space.
Yes. Yes. So this is just a quantum number, and I use it to label my eigenstate. So I can separate the spaces. That is, for each k point, I can solve independently my problem, independently from the other k. All right? Yes.
We are working in this space. The translation operator is in which space?
The translation operator is acting in real space. Ah, by the way, there is a form. You were asking me last time about the translation operator. So
IPT.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, yes. So the translation by A of the translation operator by can be written as exponential I over h bar p, the derivative operator times a. So p is h bar over I, the gradient, and one can write it this one. But actually, to prove Bloch's theorem, you don't need any explicit form, you can just use it from the property of commutation with the translation operator of the Hamiltonian.
Actually, ma'am, we know that for any case like momentum and Hamiltonian will always commute.
Yes.
So we can expand this, and obviously, if
expand.
We can just write h t a equals to t h a. The expansion will give it in a linear form.
Sure, but from the definition of the translation operator, even without any form for it, it's obvious that it commutes with the Hamiltonian, in the sense that it's an action only on the, it translates the wave function, and the potential of the crystal has this translation symmetry, so yes, I mean, but okay, alright, anyway, so this was just an aparte. Alright, so I hope I answered the question here. So we are working in real space, solving the problem in real space. Okay, now example in one dimension, given what we found. So in one dimension, maybe, I need a bit more space. Okay, so in one dimension I have a crystal with a lattice vector A, that is just the separation between my cells in real space, so the R and the real space vector of my Bravais lattice in one dimension will just be N1 times A. In one dimension I have just a series of points on a line. So this is the vector of the real space. For the reciprocal space, to build the Brillouin zone in one dimension, so my G vector would be N1 prime times 2 pi over A. These are my vector in reciprocal space, which are also on that line, on a line. So now I can construct the Brillouin zone. Maybe I will continue on the other side. Okay, so if I draw things as a function of k, I would like the energies. I know that my energies are going to depend on k. Well, in one dimension, just k. All right, so on this axis, I have my g vectors that correspond to zero, and then I have a vector, I mean, a point here that would be a 2 pi over a, and one here at minus 2 pi over a. So these are my g scalars in one dimension. So I have 0, 2 pi over a, 4 pi over a, and so on. But I know from what I have seen before that I can concentrate on the k inside the Brillouin zone. So the Brillouin zone in one dimension would go from pi over a to minus pi over a. This would be my Brillouin zone. So I have to focus on what is inside the Brillouin zone. I can forget about what is outside. I know I will have my full spectrum, all my eigenvalues focusing on k inside the Brillouin zone. Okay, so this is the Brillouin zone.
Excuse me.
Yes?
Why do you have to just put it exactly there in the middle?
This comes from the construction of the Brillouin zone. It's the beginner side cell in reciprocal space.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the Brillouin zone. All right, and then I have to solve for hk u k is equal to epsilon k u k for this k inside the Brillouin zone. And what I know is that, okay, if I fix a k inside the Brillouin zone, I will have a discrete spectrum. So I will be able to label my eigenvalues and my eigenstate with n. So n equal 1, n equal 2, n equal 3. So I order them by increasing energies. And okay, let's say I will have the first eigenvalue, epsilon 1, here. So this is my first eigenvalue. Then I will have another one, another discrete energy. And this is n equal 2, n equal 3, and so on. I will have a discrete spectrum at this given k. Now, for a k prime that is very close to k, given that the Hamiltonian H of k is analytical in k, I will have an eigenvalue which will be asymptotically close to that of the other point k. If k prime is very close to k, I will have an eigenvalue very close to the eigenvalue of the point k. Because when k prime converges, tends to k, I should get the same eigenvalue. So my eigenvalue here of the other point k prime will be very close to that of k, and the same for the second eigenvalue, the same for the third eigenvalue, and so on. So if I continue like that, I will obtain for each k point an eigenvalue that will be in the continuation. And basically, if I do it as a function of k, I will obtain for the first lower state, and end this. For the second, another band. I don't know the general, the form. What I know is that it's going to be continuous. The energy as a function of K, and that it should be discrete, so labelable with N. So, for instance, the third, and so on. So, this will be a band, epsilon 1 of K. This will be a second one, epsilon 2 of K, and so on. So I will obtain some band as a function of, continuous band as a function of K, and many of these bands, which will form what we call a band structure. So this will give a band structure that is a set of bands that continuously change with K. So this is what one can expect as a consequence of Bloch theorem and this H of K that we derived, that one has to solve for U K in a finite box, that is the limit. So this is the concept of band structure. So for each K point, I will have an energy on this band. So this was for the okay?
Yeah, so this just followed from the fact that we can label the eigenstates by K and N, and of course we know that we have energy levels that we can label as
K. Well, the first thing is that K is that one can solve this for a given K. Each you fix K, and then you solve this H of K and you get the corresponding eigenvalue. So you can solve the thing separately for each K, and then it has good properties, that is the eigenvalue have to be asymptotically close for points that are close, and so on. So
I mean, it's like you didn't specify, of course, the V of R in this case. Like, this is just
the V of R is the crystal potential. However, the crystal potential is also periodic, so you have it in the unit cell, and you use that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Yeah. But, this is in are general properties that assume, of course, potentials that are analytical and whatever. But okay, this is the reasonable consequence of the Bloch theorem. Now, there are some properties which I would like also to emphasize of the bands. And one of the properties, these are also some properties that are general. So the first one is that the band structure is periodic in reciprocal space. So the band structure is periodic if you have your band structure here in the next, if you translate by a G vector, you will have the same band structure here, here, and so on. So if you look for the eigenstate, the band structure is periodic reciprocal space. So if you go to the next cell in reciprocal state, you have the same spectrum. And this derives from the fact that if you have a K outside the Brillouin zone, so you have the eigenstate and eigenvalue, but you know that any eigenstate outside the Brillouin zone with a K outside in the Brillouin zone can be rewritten in terms of a Bloch state inside the Brillouin zone, and of course this state will be an eigenstate of the same Hamiltonian, and therefore you have the same spectrum inside and outside the Brillouin zone. Okay? All right, so the first property is that the Venn structure is periodic in reciprocal space, meaning that epsilon of k is equal to epsilon of k plus g, with j a vector of the reciprocal space. And so the second property is that the bands are symmetric, that is epsilon of, with respect to the origin, epsilon of minus k is equal, in three dimensions, let's say, to epsilon of k. So these are general properties that are valid in 1, 2, and 3 dimensions. So epsilon of minus k is equal to epsilon of k, and this is can be proven just from the properties of the Hamiltonian H of k. So H of k, one has this equation, eigenvalue equation, for a given k. H of k uk is equal to epsilon k uk, but if you take the complex conjugate of this equation, you obtain h k star uk star is equal to epsilon k, because it's real, so it doesn't change, uk of star. It's real because the Hamiltonian is Hermitian, so the eigenvalue is real. Now, if you look at the form that I gave you for h of k, and you take the complex conjugate, you see that the complex conjugate is just h of minus k. So, basically here you have the equation h of minus k u star k is equal to epsilon k u star k. So you have actually the eigenstate and eigenvalue of h of minus k. And you have that the eigenvalue of h of minus k is equal to epsilon k. So from there you have that the eigenvalue epsilon of minus k, that is the eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian h of minus k, is equal to epsilon k. And you have also that u, the eigenstate of minus for minus k, is equal to the complex conjugate of the eigenstate for k. Okay, so we have indeed that the Venn structure should be symmetric, that is h of minus k is equal to h of k. Now there is something else that I wanted to mention concerning the band structure properties, is that if one has non-degenerate bands, that is each for each eigenvalue you have just one eigenstate. So non-degenerate band must be flat. meaning zero slope, vanishing slope, and the Brillouin zone edges. And what I mean by that is, in one dimension in particular, is that if I draw as a function of k, so I have my Brillouin zone here, pi over a minus pi over a. I draw the energy. I cannot have something like that. That is a band that would have a non-vanishing slope. So, if this is the band, and this is the slope, I cannot have something like that. And the reason is that A, the property of my band is that it should be periodic. So what I have here, I should have also here. So if I have a slope like this, I should have also the same slope here, with the band that does something like that. But if I have this, so I mean, this would be the band, and in white there would be the slope. So this would be my band, and this would be the slope. I cannot have this because this is not symmetric with respect to k going to minus k. So basically, the only possibility is if my band is flat, then I can have both the periodicity condition fulfilled and the symmetry condition fulfilled. So this is the property that I mentioned here. And this, that is non-vanishing slope at the Brillouin zone edge, this is incompatible with the symmetry condition epsilon of minus k is equal to epsilon of k. So epsilon k must be symmetric. About k equal to zero. So this kind of non-flat, I mean non-zero slope at the Brillouin zone edge is incompatible with a symmetric band structure. So the band structure needs to be flat, zero slope at the Brillouin zone edge. So this is the third property that I wanted to mention. Okay. So, all right, up to here, you know, on the band structure concept and properties. Okay, so now we move to something else. So, we know that for a given crystal potential, the eigenvalue form a band structure in the Brillouin zone. And now the next question is, how will this band be filled by the electron in a given crystal? There must be filled band and empty band, like in the hydrogen atom. They are filled state, one, and empty state. So we would like to start addressing the problem of filling the bands in the crystal. We have the eigenvalue, and we want to now fill it. And to do that, we will use first the Born von Karman boundary condition. The reason is that the way we have discussed the crystal structure is for an infinite crystal. I mean, it is periodic infinitely with infinite periodicity. I mean, and the problem is we have an infinite number of electrons if we start from there, and it's a mess, so we cannot start from that large limit, from the infinite crystal. So we have to use, what we will do is consider the Born von Karman boundary condition on a finite piece of crystal, and we will then solve the filling of the electronic state in this finite piece of crystal with this boundary condition, and then we will properly take the limit when the crystal becomes very large, when n, the number of unit cell, goes to infinity, and this is the proper way of doing things. So now the next yes.
Ma'am, is it necessary that like for a given n, the band be continuous?
Yes, this comes from the analytical property of h of k. It's continuous with k.
So there is no possibility of degeneracy among k.
Because oh no, degeneracy, yes.
Because
but
if there is a degeneracy, let's say, like for a given k, it has to have two points in.
Well, but it's okay
but
in the sense.
There has to be a jump, so it will make the band discontinuous.
No. You fix the k, so you solve h of k for a given k. Nothing prevents you from having you have the first state which is non-degenerate, for instance. The second state could be degenerate, like in the hydrogen atom.
Yes, ma'am. Like, I'm not talking about degeneracy in n, but degeneracy in k for a given n.
Ah, no. I'm talking about, when I talk about degeneracy here, I'm talking about degeneracy with n.
Because since k is a good quantum number, we can talk about degeneracy in k also. Just like n, because n and k are two defining numbers for a certain
yes, but
so if we talk about degeneracy in k for a given n, there has to be a jump, because just n, it will be discontinuous.
When I talk about degeneracy here, it's always for a given k to have two ends that give the same energy, and this can happen. Band can cross anything. The degeneracy I was mentioning, and when one talks about band degeneracy, it's related to for having different n giving the same eigenvalue.
So, like, degeneracy in k is not possible, or it's not viable, because
I mean
that can be theoretically talked about, because k is a good quantum number, so we can talk about k.
Well, epsilon of it's for a given k that you can have two different n's giving the same eigenvalue. The other thing, um, is, I mean, you diagonalize each problem for a given key separately. So they don't see each other.
Yeah.
By accident, you can have a band, meaning your band structure, you can have, I don't know, it's symmetric, and it's not even accident. You can have two keys that have the same eigenvalue, but for a given k, the degeneracy would be just that you have two n that give the same eigenvalue.
Also, maybe because our approach to the problem, because we first fixed k, and then we...
Yeah, it's all done at a fixed k. That is, the subspaces at different k don't see each other.
Because the graph we later on extrapolated by saying okay, k is very close, so that.
Yeah, but this comes just from the analytical property of h of k. So I know that it's continuous h of k, and therefore I can also say something about when k tends to k prime tends to k, one gets the same eigenvalue problem. So the same since it's analytical, continuous, the h of k, it must approach it. It must tend k, the eigenvalue epsilon of k prime must tend analytically to the one of k. But this is just looking at h of k and to the form of the equation that one can see that. Okay? All right, so now let's go to the boundary conditions. Von-Karman boundary condition with the goal of filling the bands with the electrons, first for a finite piece of crystal and then telling the limit n goes to infinity, large n, the number of units. The number of pieces of crystals. So Born von Karman boundary condition. Born von Karman boundary condition. So let's do things in one dimension, which is the simplest. So I have a one-dimensional crystal, let's say monoatomic. So I have my atoms separated by distance A. So this is my A. Lattice parameter, and I have a piece of crystal that includes that has a length L, where L is n times A. So I take a piece of the crystal with n large, and this is the length of my one-dimensional crystal. Now, the Born von Karman boundary conditions, are periodic conditions for this piece of crystal over the length L equal NA of my piece of crystal. So periodic condition, and these are periodic conditions for the wave functions. So what one imposes is that C of x plus Na is equal to psi of x. So in particular, the value of the wave function here, psi must be of Na, must be equal to the value of the wave function here. And this is for large n, because we want in the end to discuss the case of an infinite crystal. Basically, what one expects is that when one has a very, very large piece of crystal, the boundary condition will not have much of an impact on the behavior of the wave function at the center of the crystal, in the bulk part of the crystal. This is related to the robustness of the bulk property on the local scale that I mentioned when we were discussing materials at the beginning, right? The property that, for instance, the gap being an insulator or a metal is essentially established on another local scale. So also here we expect that when the crystal becomes very large, the boundary condition will not really matter much for the behavior of the wave function inside the crystal in the part that is not too close to the edges of the crystal. Normal or periodic boundary condition, for instance, not expect to have a drastic impact on the behavior inside the crystal for large n. Okay, so these are the Born-von-Karman boundary conditions, and let's now see what it implies. So let's first consider remain in one dimension. So for a one-dimensional crystal, I have my Hamiltonian H of psi is equal to epsilon of psi. I know that my state for the crystal can be written as Bloch state. And now, and also that this is for, I can always just look for k inside the Brillouin zone, I will have my full spectrum. So I have to solve in principle this for k inside the Brillouin zone. And now to this state, this type of solution, I will apply this boundary condition. So now I consider the state that fulfill the boundary from Born-von-Karman boundary condition. So Born-von-Karman boundary conditions. So this means that epsilon no, sorry, exponential I k x u k of x is equal to exponential I k x plus n a u k of x plus n a. So this is just applying this boundary condition for a piece of crystal of length n a. And since my u k are periodic functions, this is just u k of x. And therefore, the imposing these boundary conditions gives me a condition on the k. So this implies that exponential I k times n a is equal to 1. So this means that k times n a must be 2 pi times an integer, and therefore that k must be equal to 2 pi times an integer divided by n a. So imposing the Born von Karman boundary conditions gives us a mesh of k that are in agreement with these boundary conditions. So here m is integer, and I will have k points on this mesh that will be separated by an increment delta k that is equal to 2 pi over n a. So I will have inside the Brillouin zone a mesh of k points with this separation. So I will have exactly n, capital N possible k, and now I can either consider n odd or n even. Yeah. In both cases I will get n solutions. Let's just take, for instance, n odd. So in this case I will have, when I consider that the k are inside the Brillouin zone, I will have m that will be between n, since it's odd, minus 1 over 2, and minus n minus 1 over 2. So it will be symmetric if I choose n, capital N odd. So, if I take instead n, capital N even, I will have the m between n over 2 and minus n over 2, but I have to exclude one of the two. So m smaller than n over 2 and larger or equal to minus n over 2. Would be the solution. In both cases, I would obtain a grid with n solutions that are separated by this increment delta n. And when the limit n tends to infinity, it doesn't really matter. I have a very, very dense mesh and just a very small difference if I choose an odd or an even. Now, okay, so the main point is that I have n allowed k value always. Okay? Now, let's see if and what this is for our one-dimensional crystal. So, if I have a one-dimensional crystal, like I had discussed before, so I have to consider the part that is inside the Brillouin zone, that is for my eigenstate, my eigenvalues, so from pi over a to minus pi over a. So this is the part that is of interest to me inside the Brillouin zone. So this is epsilon. And depending on the crystal potential, I will have different band structure, but in general, I know that I will have discrete bands, so for instance, something like this, and another band, and so on. So this depends on the crystal potential, but I'm just discussing the general properties. So I will have a band structure starting somewhere in energy, so this would be my first band. Okay, so what I know is that in the Brillouin zone, I have a mesh with n points where the that are allowed with the boundary condition I considered. So the first one would be here, m equal to 0, it would be the point in the center of the Brillouin zone. So if I'm labeling here my state, my k points, this would be m equal to 0. Then I would have m equal to 1, m equal to minus 1, and so on. Basically, inside my Brillouin zone, I will have exactly n state, n k points. That are allowed and associated to these n points, I will have also n eigenvalue in the first band. So the eigenvalue here, the eigenvalue here, 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 and so on. So in the first band, I will have exactly n k state. And the same for the second band, I will have n k state that are compatible, that are allowed with the given boundary condition I imposed. So in the Brillouin zone, I will have exactly n k state per band. To fill the bands now, and let's first consider that we have a crystal with one electron in each unit cell. So now let's say Well, okay, let's consider first the general case. Let's say we have an electron in the unit cell, and I will consider the different n. So let's have an electron per unit cell, so this means that in the crystal, in the piece of crystal, in the crystal slab, we have an electron which is given by the number of cells times an electron.
Up to n subscript e.
Okay, we have small n electron per unit cell, so let's say one electron per unit cell, two electrons per unit cell, and the total number of electrons in my piece of crystal will be n, which is the number of capital N, which is the number of unit cell, because the length of my crystal is na. Well, this can be generalized also, okay, in one dimension, times the number of electrons per unit cell, okay? All right, so now let's consider the case when we have one electron per unit cell. So it could be, for instance, the case of hydrogen, and the atoms are hydrogen. So, for instance, if I consider hydrogen, I will have one electron per unit cell. And therefore, total number of electrons in my piece of crystal will be the number of unit cell, capital N. So, and the second thing I need now to specify is for each psi of k in my band structure, I have two states, that is one corresponding to the spin-up and the other one corresponding to the spin-up. That is, for each state psi k, I can put two electrons. I can put one with the spin-up and the other one with the spin-down. So this is what I'm writing for each psi of k. So this is epsilon of k, and it has a corresponding eigenstate, which is psi of k. For each psi of k, I have two electrons, or two electronic states. I have two electronic states with spin either up or down. Two electronic states can be accommodated. So I would have Ck with spin up and Ck with spin down as possible state with the spin. So when I want to fill my band, I must fill up to having n state occupied, but state with the spin. So I have to fill up to n over 2 psi k state. So I have to fill. And we feel, of course, like in the hydrogen atom, starting from the lowest energy and increasing and, the energy when one fills up to having reach N occupied state. So I have to fill the lowest energy N over 2k states. To have N electron in my band, I have to fill up to N over 2k states. If N would be, for instance, 10, I would have to fill 5 states because each state can be occupied with a spin up and with a spin down. So I have to fill the lowest energy N over 2k space. In other words, since I have nk states here, if I have one electron per unit cell, I have to fill up to half of the band. Okay? So I'm going to fill a half band. So if you want, I have to include in the band a number of states here that would correspond to N over 2. So I would fill up to a certain point here, where what I included here, the number of k that I included, would be N over 2. States. So the part of my band that would have corresponding filled k point would be half of the Brillouin zone. I have to fill up to here, which is half. For the specific case where I have one electron per unit cell. Is it clear? Everybody agrees? Yes? No? Moderately? Okay. All right. So now, if we have instead, it comes a bit complicated. If we have instead two electrons per unit cell, I will leave the picture and continue here. So if I have two electrons per unit cell, I will fill one band. I will fill one band exactly. My picture, considering also I have to separate bands that are separated in energy. If I have two electrons per unit cell, I will have exactly, I have to fill N state N overall with the spin, so I have to fill two N state considering also the spin, and therefore I have to fill N K state. So I will completely fill my band here with two electrons per unit cell. Okay? I mean, in each state I have the wave function psi k with spin up and alpha, and psi k with spin down beta. So in a band I can exactly put two N electrons, which would correspond to the number of electrons I have with two electrons per unit cell. Okay, so now I would like to just show you, introduce the Fermi level, and just show you one case in which the bands are not like this, but where the band overlaps. Also, I wanted to say that this is valid also in three dimensions, that is also in three dimensions, and two dimension obviously. So also in three dimension, one full band corresponds to two electron per unit cell. In three dimension, the increment in k space would be 2 pi over n1 in one direction, 2 pi over n2 in the other direction, and 2 pi over n3 in the other direction, and the total number of cell would be n1 times n2 times n3. So one has the same property that can be generalized to three dimensions. So in three dimensions, if a band would be able to match exactly two electrons per cell, that is corresponding to capital N times two state would be filled, including the spin states. Okay, so let me just show you one other thing, that is, if I have, instead of my nice band separated in energy there, I have bands that have an overlap in energy, then one has to be a bit more careful when one fills. So if I consider a situation in one dimension like this, so this is K, this is my Brillouin zone, pi over A minus pi over A, and I'm plotting epsilon. So assuming I have two bands like this, this would be my first band, and for that crystal potential, my second band is like this. That is, they overlap in energy, then I have to feel a bit more careful, be a bit more careful when I feel, that is, if I have two electrons per unit cell, I must feel exactly NK states. So I have my K points here, and I have to include exactly n key points, key states. So, but I have to fill the states in order of increasing energy. So when I arrive here, I need to start filling also this band. So I have to fill up to having exactly nk states. So my Fermi energy, or the point where I will stop filling, will be something like that. That is, I will fill part, a large part of the first band and a little part of the second band, with the condition that this length here, LK1, and this length here, LK2, must be, their sum must be equal to 2 pi over a. So I must, if I have two electrons per unit cell, I must fill up to n, capital N states, and therefore I have to have L1, LK1, plus LK2 is equal to 2 pi over A. If I have this, I will have included exactly N, capital N states. Okay? I mean, it's the same idea for two electrons per unit cell. In this case, I have to fill exactly N states, so I include all that band. When the band overlap in energy, I have to include the same number of states, but I have to start filling also the second band at some point. But the sum of all points I include must be equal to n, and therefore the length of this plus the length of this must be equal to 2 pi over a. Okay?
So with filling this one, the first one, you only fill the first one, not the second one?
Yeah, because it's like in the hydrogen atom, you fill until you have the number of state that where you have included all your electrons, but you do it by increasing, you fill the lowest first and then you go up. Because you want your system to have the lowest energy in the ground state. Okay, so this now gives us the definition of the Fermi level, of the Fermi energy. This line energy in red is called the Fermi level. And here I have a metal. Here, if I have two electrons per unit cell, I have an insulator. But here I will have a metal, that is, there is no energy difference between the highest occupied state and the lowest empty state. So for a metal like here, I can define the Fermi energy, which is Fermi level of Fermi energy, which I call epsilon F. So epsilon F, which is the energy of the topmost field level in the ground state. Of my of the N electron system. So this is the definition of the Fermi energy. It's the energy of the topmost field level in the ground state of the N electron system. And this, here we talk about zero temperature. So at T equal to zero. Okay, so I will stop here. Sorry, it went a bit longer.